Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting in 2024 of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee. I'd like to remind everyone to please switch off or put to silent their mobile phones and other electronic devices. The first item of business is to decide whether to take items 6, 7 and 8 in private. Is the committee content to take these items in private?
Yes.
Under agenda item number 2, we're taking evidence from George Adam, MSP, the Minister for Parliamentary Business. This is one of our regular sessions with the Minister on the, and the Scottish Government's, with regards to the Scottish Government's work relevant to this committee. The Minister is accompanied by three Scottish Government officials, Nicola Viesdal, the LCM and Subordinate Legislation Programme Team Leader, Stephen McGregor, the Head of Parliament and Legislation Unit, and Rachel Rayner, the Deputy Legislation Coordinator in the Scottish Government Legal Directorate. I welcome you all to the committee this morning. First of all, I remind all attendees not to worry about turning on the microphones during the session, as this is dealt with by broadcasting. So I'm going to invite the Minister to make some opening remarks. Minister.
Good morning and thank you, Convener and the committee members. It's good to see you all again. First of all, I'd like to note that since my last visit, Foidal Chowdhury has joined the committee, and as a former member of the committee, I'm only too well aware of the important work that all members can make towards legislation in this committee. And I'm pleased to be back with you today to discuss matters within the committee's remit. From the Scottish Government's perspective, the last 6 months has been broadly positive. We continue to strive to bring forward the best quality legislation we can and have maintained high standards in the last quarter. Implementation of the UK Government's retained EU Law Act continues to require careful consideration of its impact on the devolved statute book, and the volume of legislation arising continues to be manageable. We have introduced the long-awaited Judicial Factors Bill, which I know the Convener is particularly keen to see progressed, and I welcome the steady progress we continue to make with implementing the Scottish Law Commission reports. I know our respective officials continue to work closely together, and I remain committed to listening carefully to the views of the committee and do my best to resolve any issues which arise. I look forward, Convener, to hearing from the committee today, and I'm happy to answer any of your questions.
Thank you very much for that, Minister. So, Minister, just at the very outset, so where the vast majority of the SSIs are not reported under any reporting ground by the committee, we do continue to identify some drafting issues on a regular basis. So can you tell me what you're doing to ensure that the quality of the SSIs remains high?
Well, I think if you look at compared to when I first attended this committee when I became a minister, there's been an improvement. Towards there's less drafting mistakes, there's deaf issues that you've been bringing up yourself. But the Scottish Government continues to striving to ensure that legislation we bring forward is robust and fit for purpose. And a significant amount of time in-house guidance and training is in place, which my officials can explain if that would be helpful.
Yes, thank you.
Okie dokie, Stephen.
Yeah, we have extensive written guidance for all of our different legislative programmes, but particularly in relation to SSIs, and that's designed to ensure that officials go through the necessary processes and understand what the Parliament is going to want to see and the type of scrutiny they'll subject those instruments to. We also do quite a lot of outreach, as we call it, so we go out and speak to a wide range of directorates within the Scottish Government, either because they may not have experience of legislation to explain to them what that will look like for them and where to get further advice, or because they're doing a lot of legislation and they might want to drive up standards. I think Social Security is an example of that. They've done a lot of work in-house and we've worked closely with them to help them with their legislation. So that's what we do on a sort of policy level. I don't know, Rachel, if you want to say something about SGLD quality assurance.
Yes, I mean, the quality of SSIs, checking is just a part of it. You know, we start by providing support and coaching and training to people, both in looking at the sort of policy, considering the legal issues, and in providing the drafting. We then have a system of checking SSIs within the team where they've been drafted. And then there's a further check by a lawyer who from a different team who's not had any involvement. And then we also have other sessions. For example, we have a monthly session where lawyers involved in drafting SSIs get together to share experience and, you know, to learn from each other, feedback issues that are arising in DPLRC. So, you know, we see it very much as a sort of whole package, working very much with sort of policy colleagues and lawyers working together to produce high quality SSIs.
think, as you can see, Convener, it's important that we have the relationship with your clerks and the committee in particular to make sure that we can work together to, if there are any issues, we can talk it over and move things forward.
No, that's helpful. Thank you. Can I just come back to Rachel? You mentioned there regarding the lawyer who hasn't been involved. Would that be kind of a different lawyer depending on the specialism and depending on the SSI?
And the idea is it's a lawyer who's not been involved, so it's a fresh pair of eyes who's coming to something fresh and then checking it on that basis because, as in many things, a fresh pair of eyes will pick up things that someone who's been very involved in the drafting may not.
So they don't need to have a specialism in that particular subject area?
No, but they are they have training and support in checking SSIs. But yes, it's the fresh pair of eyes who are experienced drafters who can often spot small things at late stages.
Okay. No, thank you. Can I ask just in terms of the kind of the wider staffing that you have, do you have is it a high turnover of staff within the legal directorate, or is it a fairly stable set of staff that you have?
I mean, the SJLD has grown within recent years, but we would make sure we're providing support and training both to people who are new, to people who are drafting a lot of the time, or people who maybe have been doing other types of work and then come back to drafting. So, different support will be needed for different types of people. But within the team that provide the last stage checking, we've had a stable team and, that's increased recently, but we don't have within that team, we don't have a concern about high turnover.
Okay, no, thank you. So since September 2023, the committee has also reported four instruments under the reporting grounds it considers to be more serious. One under ground E, which is there appears to be a doubt whether it is intravenous, and three under ground I, which is drafting appears to be defective. Are you concerned about this, Minister? Are you concerned about this trend? And has have you taken any specific actions?
How many did you say again, Convener?
It was four.
Four. Personally, I wouldn't call that a trend. I would say maybe there's been a couple of issues that we've had to do. And as always, we'll work with the committee to fix them. But I wouldn't say it was a trend.
Okay. Okay. With that, we'll move on. So, Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much, Convener. Ministers, your officials, they provide our committee and the subject committees with helpful, and I mean that, helpful they are, because otherwise we wouldn't know what we're doing, weekly update of instruments, and they're expected to bleed in the next 2 weeks following what we receive through. Can you provide an indication of the anticipated volume of SSIs likely to be laid between now and the summer, and which expected lead committees are likely to be involved?
Well, with regards to yourself, there's a significant SSI that's coming up for your own committee, which you're already aware of. And we've got no major packages on the immediate horizon. SSI volumes, easy for me to say, for the last 2 years remain lower than what we've historically laid, even pre-pandemic. But there's no particular reason for this. It's just the way things have been.
Thank you for that. And so, you're not seeing much coming forward then between now and the summer, no?
Yeah, I'm not seeing any major packages coming along in the not too distant future. But if you just want, maybe Stephen can give you some detail on that.
Yeah. I think we're looking at about 40, up to 40 instruments before summer recess, which is well within the norms. I don't have a breakdown by individual committee, but we can certainly take that away and get back to you.
Okay, well, that'd be very helpful. Thank you very much indeed. So, as we're saying there, the committee appreciates the forward looks that you provide. It really does help us a lot. Given that some of the SSIs are much longer and more complex than others, it's particularly useful to the committee, as well as relevant subject committees, to be given as much advance notice as possible of large and complex instruments or large packages, as has been mentioned, of instruments. Do you know if there are any such instruments? Well, we know there's one, or sets of instruments in the pipeline. And Are you able to keep us updated on the progress going towards this?
As always, we'll try and be as flexible with the committees or committees as we possibly can with regards to anything, but with SSIs in particular. But when you say they're complex for your own point of view as a committee member and for the committee's process, it's equally as complex for us to make sure that we get them in a place that they're actually kind of suitable to come to committee. You know, we've got to make sure we don't have any drafting errors as well. So, you know, it's kind of getting that balance so that we can actually get the information to you, but in a way that's acceptable.
Right, thank you. I know, and I think I speak on behalf of everyone saying that the drafting errors we do receive tend to be relatively minor, but they can have a bit of an influence if they're not corrected, and you do come back and correct them for us, so that's useful. But
good things about the relationship between officials and the committee is when your clerks have actually pointed out, or your committee has pointed something out, we've gone out our way to make sure we can try and fix the problem. Sure. And I think that's something we just need to continue, because our job here, me as Minister for Parliamentary Business and yourselves and DPLR, is to make this place function, you know, and it's important we get it right.
Yeah. No, so thank you very much. I don't have anything else. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Convener. I welcome those comments on trying to get things right, and just wanted to ask about some of the historic commitments that the Scottish Government's made. There's one in relation to an amendment to the Scotland Act, the Specification of Functions and Transfer of Property Order 2019 SSI 2019/183, and I just wondered if there was any progress on that you could share with the committee.
I'm not going to kid you on, Mr. Mundell. I probably knew you were going to ask this question. It's not because I'm hyper efficient at what I do, because it was about the only one that has actually taken the length. It's actually been...
I think there's another eight that are outstanding or something like that.
No, there's actually 10. Five of which are all part of the one kind of programme of stuff that we're doing. But the 2019 one that you refer to is actually older than my two youngest grandkids. It's a work that got really complicated and quite difficult for the officials to try and get it sorted. We are in the process of fixing it and getting it sorted, so it's something that we could update the committee on as we progress down that route. But I can tell you here the figure. Normally I come here and I don't tell you the exact figure of the ones that are outstanding. You said 8, it's actually 10, and there's 5 of which are all part of the one package. So it sounds more than what it actually is, because obviously 5 of them are actually for the one process.
Yeah. So, I mean, you're acknowledging that one is kind of now getting past. I mean, it's quite a long delay, and I just wanted to push you on the timescale, just so that we have a reference point, I guess, for coming back to you again if it doesn't happen. But I'm not saying the exact date, but
no, I get
when would we expect, you know, to see further progress reasonable.
I'm quite happy to be helpful in this one, Ms. Mundell, and I'll ask Nicola if she wants to give you any detail on that.
Yes, I'm happy to do that. As the Minister said, we do have 10 outstanding commitments that we're tracking in detail, and the Scotland Act order, I did some sort of investigation of the history of that, and at the moment the process with the Scotland Office has kick-started, so the policy position paper has been submitted, and from that point we can anticipate the timescales with UK Government for the Scotland Act order being between 12 and 18 months. It's a long process. The challenge, of course, was getting to that point, but we have got to that point. That kick-started in October, so 12 to 18 months from October would be either this October or the following March, and it's actually helpful for us as officials to have this committee's interest in that now, because that's a reference point that we can use to point to Scotland Office in terms of our then following up with them to make sure they stay on track. So your interest in it is actually very helpful in terms of making sure that this stays on track. And as the Minister said, the other 9 remaining commitments, 5 relate to a package of pensions, SSIs. I won't list them all. They're different kinds of pensions for different kinds of people, but all in relation to that package. That's 6 dealt with. And then there are 4 remaining commitments from the 10, and those will be addressed in further identified SSIs that we anticipate laying within the next 12 months. So that hopefully gives you a timescale.
Yeah, no, that is really helpful and really clear, and we'll enjoy seeing the Minister back next March to be able to ask.
I look forward to it, Mr. Mundell, and I'll keep this note that my policy officials got: do not pick a fight with Mr. Mundell.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. So just on that kind of outstanding, the longest outstanding issue, would you find it helpful if the committee were to write to the Scotland office? I know we have had engagement with them in the past, but the fact that that document has now been sent to them...
I don't see it being unhelpful. I think that would be quite helpful for us as well, because it makes the argument that we've all got to work together to make this deliverable.
Okay. Great. No, thank you. Faisal Chowdhury.
Good morning. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and the team. The question I have for you, I'm sure I won't pick a fight on you since it's the first question I'm asking you. The committee does not regularly comment on explanatory notes which accompany instruments, but it would be interested to know more about what the usual process for the drafting and checking of explanatory note is. Are the minister and his officials able to set that detail for us?
So basically just how we go about explanatory notes, Mr. Chowdhury, is that what you mean?
Yep.
Okay then, well, rather than me waffle on for a couple of minutes, I will go straight to Stephen and he will probably go straight to Rachel.
Thank you. Explanatory notes are part of the SSI, so they are drafted as part of the SSI and they have the same checking process as the SSI. They're not done separately. I mean, the purpose of an explanatory note is to enable somebody who doesn't know what the instrument is about to pick it up, look at the explanatory note and understand what the instrument is about. Is this something they're interested in? Is this something they want to find out more about? Explanatory notes should be concise. They're not trying to explain every small part of the drafting. Obviously, there's an element of judgment involved, that what one person finds concise and helpful, another person may prefer a little more information, or somebody may prefer a little less. But I think on the whole, we get that judgment right. And on occasions where there are different views, we're happy to consider that and take action if we think we didn't get the judgment quite right in a particular case.
Ironically, on this issue, I was at conveners, my annual visit to the conveners group, and you might remember, convener, when we were there, there was two conveners that believed the explanatory notes were too detailed, and there was one convener that believed it wasn't enough detail. So in a lot of cases, it's in the eye of the beholder and what people actually want from it as well. But that, again, is something where my officials try to get the balance to make sure that we've given you enough detail. And I mean that with all kind of publications that we do with bills as well, not just explanatory notes.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I have another question for you. When delegated powers, which are exercisable within devolved competence, are not mentioned on the face of an LCM, does that mean that the Scottish Government is content with the UK Government's proposal to take these powers? We asked this question in the context of recently considering the LCM for the UK Parliament's Criminal Justice Bill, which did not mention any or commensurate powers, which confirmed powers on UK ministers in the devolved areas.
When it comes to LCMs, it's become increasingly challenging for us to manage that in particular. I think partly that's because of the political situation. Let's not kid ourselves on. There is a political situation there, but it's also partly a result of amendments and everything else that we get from Westminster government themselves. I mentioned this the last time when we're actually going through the process of LCMs, was the fact that I tried to look at it from the UK government's perspective, as opposed, because I'm always coming here and I'm going elsewhere and thinking from our perspective. When they're drafting legislation, it's not as if they're going out their way. They don't take into account the fact that how it's going to affect Scotland. But the problem for us is that we have to make sure that we take that into account. Now, I don't know if this answers your question, but we've been working recently with the Parliament on a way to deal with that. And the Automated Vehicles Bill was an example where there was all kinds of Road Traffic Act fallout from the LCM itself. But in order to try and balance out the time, we came up with a legislative LCM memo that we didn't actually have the government's position on it, but we actually did it within the timescales so that we could actually get that out there and actually do it within our timescales, but then still give us the time as a government to see what that impact is. Because on one hand, this committee quite rightly is asking me about the quality of the drafting and answers and everything else that we're doing. But on the other hand, there's a timescale for everything as well. So that's an example of a way we've tried to make it easier for us to manage that. I don't know if that's helpful for Mr. Chowdhury in his answer. I'll maybe bring in Stephen again just to maybe sum up some of the other bits and pieces.
Yeah, just in relation specifically to the Criminal Justice Bill, I wonder if we can take that one away. I mean, generally speaking, if there are powers of UK ministers to act in devolved areas, that triggers the requirement for an LCM, and the Legislative Consent Memorandum should describe what those powers are and what the Scottish Government's position is on them. So I think I would need to take that one away and have a look at it, if that's OK.
But we're happy to do that on that scenario, and also the fact, as I say, the LCM landscape is quite difficult, but I'm trying to dispassionately go through it all and make sure we just do our jobs.
Just a last just a question, if I may, Convener. If our committee writes to the Westminster and they ignore it, what do we have to do?
Well, I'm not telling you to go and Mr. Chowdhury, to go down and chain yourself to Downing Street or anything like that. But I think, on the whole, it's helpful when the committee does make any kind of written kind of appeal on our behalf, because I think it's important that although we work in a political environment, it's important that when we're trying to just make things function and get the business done, it's important that we kind of try to be adults about it. So it's always helpful when the committee makes any intervention in these things. So I would encourage you to continue doing so.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
OK, thank you, Faisal. Oliver, you wanted a supplementary.
It was to come back firstly on the kind of explanatory note points, because I noted you said some of it's kind of down to the eye of the beholder. But obviously across the government, there are a lot of different ministers introducing lots of different bills. And it just was to kind of push a wee bit on what's done to ensure, certainly in relation to the explanatory notes, that there is a kind of common kind of understanding of what's needed. Because I think, you know, obviously we're hearing some conveners think too much, too little, you know, and that's, you know, that the Parliament's kind of got the opportunity to say that. But I think we've certainly seen some things recently, you know, where there is a kind of degree of variation, and it'd just be, you know, is that balance? I know there's a balance.
Yeah.
Is there someone working across government to
there
ensure
is a,
that all
there is
bills
a standardised
are...
template? You know, you'll be glad to know that the ministers don't sit there and decide what the accompanying documentation is.
They do look at those and sign them off. As
yes,
part,
they
before
do.
They introduce the bill.
Yes, as part of the process.
It's kind of what happens to make sure, you know, that everyone kind of knows kind of what the minimum standard is in terms of. I'm less worried about there being too much information. And I think the harder ones is where, you know, where there isn't as much.
Well, I was going to answer your question there, but Rachel's champing at the bit here, so I'll let Rachel answer.
Yes, so obviously that sort of issue would be covered in guidance, but also that's something we would feed back. So I'm aware, you know, recently that there was a question raised and a response given and an explanatory note amended by way of correction slip. That will be fed back. That's something we will, you know, raise to remind people that, you know, what is the purpose of an explanatory note, to think about what information needs to be included in there. So, so when points are raised, we do feed them back.
That's helpful. I had something else on the LCMs as well, but I see.
Sure. Is it on this particular area?
Yeah.
No problem. Okay.
And I think you were just about to say, Minister, sorry, good morning, Minister, and good morning, Chief Minister. I think you were just about to say there is a template which people follow. Does, before the Minister sign the document off, does it go to somebody within your team, whether that's Stephen or Rachel, to cast an eye over it just to make sure that it's falling within that, or is it left to each ministerial department?
Parliamentary liaison unit, Stephen runs, is party to everything that goes on, all the legislation that goes through the Parliament. So they will be the ones that will be oversight of just about everything. Stephen, if you want to add anything to that?
We don't check every instrument. I mean, there's too many of them, literally, for us to do that. But we have in the past done a sample exercise, particularly when this committee has raised concerns. I think previously it was in relation to policy notes. So that's something we can look at again if there are concerns from the committee about the quality of the information. The explanatory notes, there is a template, there is guidance about what's expected. I think these examples that you're giving us are really helpful for us to be able to say, along with this slightly abstract guidance, here's a practical example of what the committee wasn't happy with, so let's avoid that in the future going forward. And as Rachel said, there is a second pair of eyes, an SGLD, who looks at it. So there's quite a high degree of guidance and quality assurance already in place.
Thank you.
Yeah. Before I bring you in, Oliver, by way of a wee bit of balance on this, I think this is the first time for quite some time that this committee has raised the issue of the explanatory notes. And because I think, in fairness, I think that they've been fine in terms of the instruments. But because this one was really quite obvious that there was a lack of detail. So it's not as if this is a recurring issue when it comes to explanatory notes, and certainly it's not a trend. But it was really quite stark. So just to make you aware of that.
As Stephen says, we'll take that on board.
Great.
And we try to use these sessions as a way of us trying to see how can we do things better.
Yeah, thank you. Oliver?
Yeah, so just following up on the question around LCMs, I think part of the challenge is where the Scottish Government says kind of nothing or is silent on the powers. It's just whether we should assume that means you're content, or whether it's just that capacity question where you kind of run out of capacity or time to kind of query every bit of are you prioritising, or is it where you say nothing about a power, we can take it that you're content and happy with it?
I think every LCM, if you've not heard anything, don't. The government's position isn't available until the government's made its position clear. Most of the time, if you're hearing nothing, it'll be because... if I use the automated vehicles as an example, that was quite complex and quite detailed. So by the time you go through it, it took quite a while for us to kind of get the detail. Now, if you took the assumption that we were happy with it, well, that wasn't the case. It was just that we were actually getting our ducks in a row so that we could actually make the arguments that there were certain kickbacks that the UK government hadn't assumed would be a problem for the Scottish government.
I guess it's once you've commented, though, is that a complete comment and that's you finished in relation to that LCM, or is it... No, so
the position can be pretty flexible, as you'll be aware, because there could be negotiations between officials, there could be negotiations between ministers over that period, and that position could change. I think there's been a couple of LCMs, can't think off the top of my head, where our position has actually changed because we have negotiated, the UK government has accepted our position and we've moved on. There's been other times where the UK government hasn't accepted our position, and we've had to say that we're coming out and with the LCM saying we're not happy.
So, I guess moving forward then, would you make kind of more of a conscious effort, I guess, to say where there are things you are happy with so that we would know they weren't things we needed to look at, where you were silent? Because I think that's the thing at the moment. Your sort of stuff tends to provide a commentary on the things you're most concerned about, and then say nothing at all about the other bits, and then we have to make a kind of
I think you're being a wee bit unfair because I don't think that's the case. That might be, I think that's maybe the political narrative between ourselves if we started to go down a political argument. But within the actual process itself, there has been plenty of times where the government has made its position clear that we are supportive of the LCM and want to make the changes.
So I'm saying, for example, round commencement powers or round things that would... obviously, even within things that you don't agree with, there can be some of the there can be some of the powers within it that wouldn't be a cause for concern. And I think we're trying to work out which bits to focus on.
I think
on.
There have been a number of examples recently as well where there's been parts that we've not been happy with, and we've made everybody aware of the parts we're not happy with. But there's other parts that we were quite happy with. I actually read everything that comes in that goes in with regards to LCM, but I can't at this moment think off the top of my head. But Stephen, perhaps you could give me some examples to back me up here.
I wasn't aware this was an issue, to be honest, so it's something we're happy to take away. If there's, as I said previously, if there's devolved powers in the UK bill, then we would expect to set out the Scottish Government's position on them. I don't know if this is an issue of whether supplementary LCMs, where we might have said an original LCM what our position was on parts of the bill, and then an updated LCM doesn't recover them because they've been addressed already, or whether it's powers that aren't actually touching on devolved areas. So if we can take it away and have a look into it for you, we'd be happy to get back with more.
You know, that's fine. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. And Jeremy Balfour.
Good morning again. The Scottish Government has made commitments to amend delegated powers at stage two of a number of bills recently, which are going through Parliament. For example, the Regulation of Legal Services Scotland Bill, which the committee has scrutinised and reported on at stage one since the last appearance. Given the potential significance of the amendment of delegated powers at stage two, can the Minister commit to allowing more than the minimum time permitted by standing orders between the submission of supplementary delegated powers memorandum after stage two and the scheduling of stage three, to allow the committee sufficient time to consider and report to Parliament on any new amended delegated powers?
Mr. Balfour, I'm always looking for there's a hard and an easy way to do business, and if I could find that easy way and get it to you beforehand, I would. But unfortunately, we don't live in that perfect world, and that's not as simple for us to achieve. But wherever possible, we will try and get the information to you as quickly as we can, but it can be, as we've already heard today, quite complex. I don't know if Stephen wants to add anything with regards to that.
I think improvements have been made in this over the years. I mean, it's come up in previous inquiries from the Parliament into the legislative process that Delegate Powers and Law Reform Committee didn't always have as much time as it would like between stage two and stage three. So I think we've given a commitment which we try and meet, which is to write to the committee if there's going to be any significant powers amended at stage three with as much information about that as possible. And I think in the scheduling of stage threes, we try and ensure that there's at least one session of DPLRC before a stage three takes place.
Yeah, I mean, I think at the moment we're also looking at between the stage one debate and the stage two. So, for example, if we take the example of the Regulation of Legal Services Bill, during that debate, the Minister committed to bringing forward a number of amendments, some of them relating to delegated power. Now, we as a committee don't normally take evidence after stage one, but on this time, I think both myself and the convener made a point that we might need to take evidence to see what the professional bodies feel about that. Now, that takes time, just to give a week to be able to write to the Law Society, to write to the Lord President, for us to then weigh that evidence and be able to report in an appropriate way. So I suppose, as Minister, what discussions do you have with your colleagues when it's particularly legislation that's looking for fairly major amendments?
You've actually brought up something, that, again, which is a classic example of why these committee sessions are good, of something that we haven't really discussed. And possibly, if you give me the opportunity to maybe have a look at that, Mr. Balfour, and get back to you at a later date.
Not too late, indeed.
Not too late.
Thank you, Minister. Moving on, what reflections have there been within Scottish Government as to some of the concerns raised in relation to delegated powers? So I think you've heard from not just this committee, but others saying bills are moving quite down with a lot of delegated powers. Is that something, is a concern to you? Is it something that's discussed within Scottish Government?
Well, there isn't a kind of trend, again, to use the buzzword of today, towards us actually having more delegated powers for legislation. But what tends to be happening is, in various kind of bills, there is the classic example of co-design of the bill and making sure that it actually does what we want it to do. So I would think, in fact, from your and my point of view, I think both of us were on the Social Security Committee in the last session where we did the Social Security Bill. I don't know if you were on it at that stage, Mr. Balfour. And I think the way we did it in that bill was a perfect example of how you can make it work in such a way that you can actually deliver what you're saying, you know. And at the end of the day, with the public, we can sit here and talk about legislation all day for hours, but the public just believe in delivery. And if I use the Social Security Act and how we went about that as well. In fact, I'll go as far as I think our former colleague on the same committee, Professor Tompkins, actually said that bill and the work we did during that period was a perfect example of how the committee. He was on the committee at the time, so I don't know if he had to declare say that he actually had to do with some of the work, but he used that as an example. And I think there are certain times when you do that where it actually delivers what we want to do, and it's flexible for us all.
So is your position, Minister, that we're not having more, if you like the word, framework bills? Because my impression, and I'm happy to be corrected, that within this session of Parliament, so the last 3 years, we've seen a lot more framework bills than we did in previous parliamentary sessions.
Actually, I had a fair idea this question would come up because the political narrative has been down that route as well, and we've checked that and we've not had any more than normal. It's not any more when we discuss it as well as the UK government as well. And I know everybody gets a bit kind of upset when we start doing like for like, but I'm comparing it to another parliament and their processes with regards to that as well. And on the whole, we actually aren't doing that. But if you listen to the discussion in parliament, you would think something entirely different, but it's not the case.
Oliver McGillan, yeah, sure, for sure, supplementary on
sure. This. Yeah. No, I mean, to me, it's actually not a political issue. For me, the concern is about Parliament having its say. And to me, you made the case for that, you know, in your own comments, because politicians can spend all day talking about legislation. Most of my constituents don't have the time. Whilst they want to see delivery and they want to see things work, they don't have the time to go through legislation letter by letter, word by word, to make sure it works. And ultimately, if the legislation doesn't work, you don't get the delivery. And to me, the big concern that's coming down the line, whilst there might not be more framework bills, they are on more substantive topics. You know, things like agricultural funding are very, very complicated. You know, there will be a lot of secondary legislation needed to make that work. You know, National Care Service is exceptionally complicated. There will need to be a lot of secondary legislation to make that work. And I'm concerned really whether the Parliament as a whole has the capacity, you know, to deal with that level of secondary legislation on what are going to be, you know, what I think are going to be controversial topics. And we've seen that with the regulation of legal services as well. You know, people do have strong views, you know, on some things that are being left to secondary legislation. And, you know, is this committee going to have people in every week, you know, to talk about each and every one of these that are, you know, contentious in terms of policy? And I just wonder, is that something the government's thought about, how that's going to work in practice?
I think, well, and to answer your final question at the end there, we'll work with the committee to do whatever work we have to do to do the work of Parliament, as we always do. But I take your point on board. I don't agree with your point, but I take on board what you're saying. My argument would equally be, if I use the Social Security example, with that actually kind of the secondary legislation and the working with stakeholder groups and making sure that's what made the difference. Now, there's always going to be, even when you get a broad church of stakeholder groups into one room, There's always going to be those that feel that they're not getting their point across. But on the whole, when this process happens, that's to give us that flexibility. My argument would be that gives the flexibility for those that are actually involved in the delivery of the process or on the receiving end of delivery of the process are the ones that are being consulted with. But I take on board the workload issue. We'll maybe look at that for maybe a future chat that we have with yourselves and see how that would look when we go further down the line. Difficult one to actually kind of deal with, but to try and kind of make sure that the committee feels that we're taking on board what you're saying, I'm quite happy to have a look at that.
Thank you, because I mean, I think it's possible two or three of these could come together, you know, and you could, you know, we talked about how many, you know, SSIs are expected before the summer, but you could go through periods where there are real kind of peaks, and, you know, in what's coming through the department. It's not just this committee, it's the other subject committees as well, you know, who are then trying to look at other new legislation. I think that's definitely something. But, you know, I hear what you're saying around the flexibility and, you know, that some people are always going to be unhappy. I would ask, do you kind of recognise there is a challenge where these kind of discussions are taking place kind of away from, you know, away from the Parliament? You know, that there are some stakeholders, some people who worry, you know, that those with kind of louder voices or who are able to lobby harder or who have more professional support, you know, might have the chance, you know, or may politically be perceived to be closer to the government, you know, might have a better chance, you know, of getting what they want through that process than they would if it went to Parliament as a whole and was subjected to the full scrutiny of primary legislation.
I think
the
Scottish Government in these processes tends to make sure that it listens to, when we say we're going to listen to everybody and we're going to co-design or we're going to make sure that everybody's voice is listened to, they are listened to. Whether the conclusions are always what every single individual wants is always that's the argument. But for me, the important thing would always be that we make sure that we deliver on what we've promised in that legislation. And
do you recognise there's a tension there? Do you recognise it? I mean, there is a tension, whether or not you think it works well, there is a tension.
I think there's a political tension. I don't think it's a process tension. I think there's a political tension there.
So, I mean, I take the, you know, the Agricultural and Rural Communities Bill as an example. You know, we have a GIQ, you know, that sets out that 70% of funding for that would go into, you would go into tier one and two as direct payments. So that decision's been taken by the government before the kind of stakeholder consultation formally begins. So that's possible while the bill's going through. But it's not possible to get some of the other information, you know, that you would normally expect with a bill on the details. So the government's kind of picking and choosing, you know, which.
I know, but it's never a great idea to write everything in the face of the bill. If we take that argument to the next level.
But there's a balance, there's a tension. There's a tension. That's what I'm asking. Do you accept
there is a balance
tension?
And there is a tension. I believe it's a political tension, but there is a balance and there is a political tension there. But I do believe that you have to be very careful, because once it's on the face of a bill, it's law. And if you find that something at a later date doesn't work as well as you thought it was going to work, and that's not down to any drafting issues or anything else, it's just that it's maybe a clumsy piece of law, then you've not got the flexibility to be able to change that. So
the last thing I say is you can put it on the face of the bill when it goes through Parliament and retain the flexibility to change it later, and that's different from not putting it on the face of the bill at all and leaving it to secondary legislation.
I think you and I, Mr. Mandela, are playing out the kind of political pressure.
It's not political. It's not political. I don't think framework bills are good in any Parliament. Uh-huh. I think there are times when they can be used, but I think you have to have enough information on the face of the bill for parliamentarians and the public to know what their national parliament's passing before people cast their vote, and not just to say the rest will come later once it's agreed. I don't think that's a good way to work.
And it's never, well, that's your opinion. My opinion is it gives us the flexibility to be able to deliver to the public and engage with the public through the process.
You could do that consultation before the bill is brought, and then have that still have the flexibility. But you know, I don't think this is actually... I mean, I think I'm a bit like my colleague, Mr. Mandel. I think purely on a philosophical view, there is a tension there. I don't think it's a political one. I think I would have the same concerns about what sometimes happens at Westminster. But you could do the consultation before the bill comes to Parliament, so Parliament still gets that final say yes or no.
Listen, as I say, I still believe there is it's more of political tension, but that's my personal view. Yourself, Mr. Balfour, and Mr. Mandel have already expressed your view on it. I think we're going to have difficulty actually agreeing on that.
OK, well, let's move on to something I'm sure we can all agree on. And that is the committee was contacted by the Lord President during its consideration of the delegated powers in the Regulation of Legal Services Bill, which had misgivings about some of the proposals to delegate powers to his office. I wonder if you can help me out here. What procedures are followed when a bill is being drafted and a decision is made to delegate power, particularly when a power is being delegated to a body which is not within the Scottish Government?
OK, I'll ask Stephen.
And I think in general terms, we would expect there to be engagement with the relevant bodies about the approach being taken, but that, I would have to take that specific case away and find out what actually happened on it.
Yeah, I mean, I think that would be helpful because there did seem to be a real... It's not often you get the Lord President, the Law Society and the Faculty of Advocates, two out of the three came and gave evidence to his committee, who seemed to be almost taken by surprise about what was still there. So it would be helpful if you could come back to us on that one. And with that, I will leave my questions. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Do we have any other questions, colleagues? No, okay. So with that, can I thank the Minister and his officials for their evidence this morning. The committee may follow up by letter with any additional questions stemming from the session. So thank you very much, everyone. And
thank
with
you,
that,
convener.
I'll suspend the meeting to allow the witnesses to leave the room. Under agenda item number 3, we're considering an instrument subject to the affirmative procedure. No points have been raised on the draft registration of social workers and social service workers in Care Services Scotland Amendment Regulations 2024. Is the committee content with this instrument?
Yes.
Under agenda item number 4, we're considering an instrument subject to the negative procedure. No points have been raised on SSI 2024-74. Is the committee content with this instrument? Under agenda item number 5, we're considering an instrument not subject to any parliamentary procedure. No points have been raised on SSI 2024-75. Is the committee content with this instrument?
Yes.
Thank you. And with that, I'll move the committee into private.